Come, let us make bricks and a tower to reach heaven. Nothing we propose will be withheld from us. Come, let us make a name for ourselves. Then we will be like God. We are confused in our language and dispersed in our hearts. Lord, let our diversity become our unity as one family. See what love the Father has given us, that we should all be called the children of God. And so we'll sing a hymn called All People That on Earth Do Dwell. I think you'll recognize the tune. It's basically the doxology tune. There are four or five verses to it, though. Again, and let's all pray together our corporate prayer. We meet as family in the presence of our Heavenly Father. We meet as brothers and sisters in Christ, accepting the responsibility this places upon us to love one another as you have loved us. We meet as your lights in this dark world, and pray that through our words and our lives, others might be drawn into your family and accept you as their Savior and Lord. Amen. All right, we're going to continue in the book of Genesis and read chapter 10. We'll then, a little bit later, be reading chapter 11, which actually stops and goes back before what we're going to read now to explain how this all came to be. This is the account of Shem, Ham, and Japheth, Noah's sons who themselves had sons after the flood. The sons of Japheth: Gomer, Magog, Madai, Javan, Tubal, Meshech, and Tiras. The sons of Gomer: Ashkenaz, Riphath, and Togarma. The sons of Javan: Elisha, Tarshish, the Kittim, and the Rodanim. From these, the maritime peoples spread out into their territories by their clans within their nations, each with its own language. The sons of Ham: Cush, Mitzrayim, Put, and Canaan. The sons of Cush: Seba, Havilah, Sabta, Ra'amah, and Sabtika. The sons of Ra'amah: Sheba, and Dedan. Cush was the father of Nimrod, who grew to be a mighty warrior on the earth. He was a mighty hunter before the Lord, and that is why it is said, like Nimrod, a mighty hunter before the Lord. The first centers of his kingdom were Babylon, Erech, Akkad, and Calneh in Shinar. From that land he went to Assyria, where he built Nineveh, Rehoboth, Calah, and Rezin, which is between Nineveh and Calah. That is the great city. Mitzrayim was the father of the Ludites, the Anamites, Lehabites, Naphtuhites, Pathrusites, Casluhites, from whom the Philistines came, and the Kaphtorites. Canaan was the father of Sidon, his firstborn, and of the Hittites, the Jebusites, Amorites, Girgashites, Hivites, Arkites, Sinites, Arvadites, Zemarites, and Hamathites. Later, the Canaanite clan scattered, and the borders of Canaan reached from Sidon toward Gerar as far as Gaza, and then toward Sodom, Gomorrah, Admah, Zeboim, as far as Lasha. These are the sons of Ham, by their clans and languages in their territories and nations. Sons were also born to Shem, whose older brother was Japheth. Shem was the ancestor of all the sons of Eber. The sons of Shem: Elam, Ashur, Arphaxad, Lud, and Aram. The sons of Aram: Uz, Hul, Gether, and Meshech. Arphaxad was the father of Shelah, and Shelah the father of Eber. Two sons were born to Eber. One was named Peleg, because in his time the earth was divided. His brother was named Joktan. Joktan was the father of Almadad, Sheleph, Hazamaveth, Jerah, Hadoram, Uzal, Dikla, Obal, Abimael, and Sheba, Ophir, Havilah, and Jobab. All these were sons of Joktan. The region where they lived stretched from Meshah toward Sephar in the eastern hill country. These are the sons of Shem by their clans and languages, in their territories and nations. These are the clans of Noah's sons, according to their lines of descent within their nations, from these nations spread out over the earth after the flood. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And now let's sing a song in celebration of that, amen? The family of God, we're all part of the same family. Well, before we go on and read and talk some more about being one family, I'd like to take a little time out here and go before the Lord in prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Okay, as I said, we're going to pick up and read chapter 11 from Genesis, which once again goes back and sort of explains what happened before chapter 10 to cause things to be that way, following the flood of Noah that we've been talking about. Hear the word of the Lord from Genesis 11. Now the whole world had one language and a common speech. As men moved eastward, they found a plain in Shinar and settled there. They said to each other, "Come, let's make bricks and bake them thoroughly." They used brick instead of stone and tar for mortar. Then they said, "Come, let us build ourselves a city with a tower that reaches to the heavens, so that we may make a name for ourselves and not be scattered over the face of the whole earth." But the Lord came down to see the city and the tower that the men were building. The Lord said, "If as one people speaking the same language they have begun to do this, then nothing they plan to do will be impossible for them. Come, let us go down and confuse their language so they will not understand each other." So the Lord scattered them from there all over the earth, and they stopped building the city. That is why it was called Babel, because there the Lord confused the language of the whole world. From there the Lord scattered them over the face of the whole earth. This is the account of Shem. 2 years after the flood, when Shem was 100 years old, he became the father of Arphaxad. And after he became the father of Arphaxad, Shem lived 500 years and had other sons and daughters. When Arphaxad had lived 35 years, he became the father of Shelah. And after he became the father of Shelah, Arphaxad lived 403 years and had other sons and daughters. When Shelah had lived 30 years, he became the father of Eber. And after he became the father of Eber, Shelah lived 403 years and had other sons and daughters. When Eber had lived 34 years, he became the father of Peleg. And after he became the father of Peleg, Eber lived 430 years and had other sons and daughters. When Peleg had lived 30 years, he became the father of Reu. And after he became the father of Reu, Peleg lived 209 years and had other sons and daughters. When Reu had lived 32 years, he became the father of Serug. And after he became the father of Serug, Reu lived 207 years and had other sons and daughters. When Serug had lived 30 years, he became the father of Nahor. And after he became the father of Nahor, Serug lived 200 years and had other sons and daughters. When Nahor had lived 29 years, he became the father of Terah. And after he became the father of Terah, Nahor lived 119 years and had other sons and daughters. After Terah had lived 70 years, He became the father of Abram, Nahor, and Haran. This is the account of Terah. Terah became the father of Abram, Nahor, and Haran. And Haran became the father of Lot. While his father Terah was still alive, Haran died in Ur of the Chaldeans, in the land of his birth. Abram and Nahor both married. The name of Abram's wife was Sarai, and the name of Nahor's wife was Milcah. She was the daughter of Haran, the father of both Milcah and Iscah. Now Sarai was barren, she had no children. Terah took his son Abram, his grandson Lot of Haran, and his daughter-in-law Sarai, the wife of his son Abram, and together they set out from Ur of the Chaldeans to go to Canaan. But when they came to Haran, they settled there. Terah lived 205 years, and he died in Haran. This is the word of the Lord for the people of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Can we talk? Can't we all just get along? Those are two questions we often hear in our culture today, don't we? And they're also colloquialisms from our modern conversational American English. You talking to me? There's another one. A colloquialism. Colloquial is a Latin word that means speaking together, which speaks to our topic today. Conversation, cooperation, rebellion, confusion, separation. That's the basic sequence of events that humans experienced from the time of Noah's flood through the occasion of the Tower of Babel. And the story of the Tower of Babel is not some myth, like many people say, but it was a real event in history that dramatically changed our world and which explains many things that would otherwise be mysteries. And today, almost everywhere we look in our world, we see diversity. We see varied languages, contrasting religions, and a wide assortment of people groups with different skin tones. And you notice I say skin tones, not skin color. We're basically all the same color, just differing shades. And such dissimilarities can all be traced back to this one major event in history, when God confused the languages at Babel and dispersed Noah's descendants all throughout the world. Unfortunately, though, not too much has changed with people in the last 4,000 years. Since Babel, we still want to do things our way and make a name for ourselves, don't we? We all have our own ideas about the way things should be. Nations that once feared God now ignore him and despise his word. Children from godly homes are rebelling against the faith of their parents. Fortunately, though, God has recorded key moments in history to warn and comfort us. We are his people. And as 1 Corinthians 10:11 says, these things happened to them as examples for us. They were written down to warn us who live at the end of the age. And Romans 15:4 tells us, such things were written in the scriptures long ago to teach us, and the scriptures give us hope and encouragement as we wait patiently for God's promises to be fulfilled. So we may get discouraged by the sins of our nation and the sins of our children, but God wants to encourage us. And a quick walk through this, the Bible's account of Babel reveals some important lessons for us today. As I said, God is still patiently working out his plans, even though we can't always see how. And to properly understand this account of Babel, we must remember the circumstances in which Moses presented it to the Hebrew people. They had just been freed from slavery in Egypt about 1491, and they were about to enter the promised land where they would be told to destroy the wicked nations of Canaan. And they needed to understand where these nations and people came from and why God had the authority to judge them for their sin and to tell them to go and kill them. They needed to know why. And some people claim that through this, the Bible promotes racism. Partly because of that conquest of Canaan, but I say that's nonsense. Because the histories of Adam and Noah and this event at Babel teach us that we are all one race, all of one blood, literally all the same family made in the image of God. And as usual, today modern science confirms this biblical claim, since the Human Genome Project clearly has concluded that all humans are indeed genetically just one race. It's one race of humans. And so, when thinking about a picture of God, what he looks like, I like to think of a tapestry created by the portraits of all the different people in the world. All together look like God in his image. And Moses, who wrote down these records, knew about the history, about the geography, the languages and cultures of his world. He had been trained in the court of Pharaoh. And yet, he didn't rely on his education because God spoke to him directly. And God's words, whether spoken to Moses or recorded in the Bible for us today, are the highest authority that we could or should ever want and need. And after the flood, God had commanded Noah's descendants to be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth. But instead, they put down roots with no apparent intention to spread out and replenish the earth. Genesis 11:4 says, "Then they said, 'Come, let us build ourselves a city with a tower that reaches to the heavens, so that we may make a name for ourselves and not be scattered over the face of the whole earth.'" They had their own ideas. And these settlers at Babel went out of their way to ensure that they would not be scattered, contrary to what God had commanded. They put down those roots in one place, building a tower that they could rally around. And when you read through this again, notice the words "us," "ourselves," and "we." See, Moses makes it clear that pride was the real problem here at Babel. Because building cities and towers is not evil, but proud motives can turn even the most worthwhile activities into sin. Because any human activity, if done for the wrong reason, can be wicked. And as Proverbs 21:4 warns, haughty eyes, a proud heart, and evil actions are all sin. And these rebels wanted to build their tower to reach to the heavens, which is the same figure of speech that was used later in Deuteronomy to describe those cities of Canaan as walled up to heaven. Same phrase of speech there. And then there's also some question about the real purpose of the tower. Why did they actually build this thing? Just like a picture on my tie, I have a Tower of Babel tie today. And there's been, as I said, a lot of speculation about what was the purpose of that. Some have suggested that they wanted to build a structure large enough and strong enough to survive another flood, if one ever came. But that doesn't really make sense to me, because why would they build it then down in the plains instead of up on a mountain? Well, other commentators, like Martin Luther, suggest that the builders wanted to construct a symbol of their self-reliance. In other words, the rebels were pretty much shaking their fist at heaven, as it were, by building such a great structure in their own power. And early Jewish writers and Christian commentators suggest that the tower was probably the first center of false religion in this post-flood world. Revelation 17 also indicates that Babel was the mother of world religions. And one recent suggestion is that, like the ziggurat buildings built in later cities in that region, the tower was a symbolic bridge between heaven and earth, a place where the gods could come down to earth or to stop and rest. And while God does interact with humans in unusual ways, as we read about, for example, in the account of Jacob's ladder in Genesis 28, it is the height of folly, really, to think that humans can bridge the gap themselves between the physical world and the spiritual world through their own efforts. We cannot do that. We need God to help us do that. So, how did this all actually happen? How did it play out? Well, let's just imagine it for a minute here. Imagine finding yourself on a construction project for this great tower, where the guy working next to you, the bricklayer, who understood you just fine a minute ago, is suddenly scratching his head as if he doesn't understand a single word you're saying. And worse yet, as soon as he starts to tell you what's wrong, you don't understand him either. In fact, some of your nearby co-workers you're seeing cannot understand anyone else. It's all become a bunch of babble. And your heart sinks. You start to realize that this must be God's judgment, as everyone's heart has told them while staying here and working on this project. They all knew what God had commanded them to do. But then you decide to leave work and run home before quitting time because you can see pandemonium is gripping the city. But to your great relief, when you get home, you find that your wife and your children can still understand you. Thank God. And a sudden desperate bond joins you as never before. But you go out and tears flow as you and your family rush to the homes of neighbors and playmates, only to find that most of them now utter sounds that just don't compute. And before the sun has set on that day, it's become clear that your comfortable world is going to have to be restructured. In fact, the changes have already begun, and you find that in order to obtain needed food and supplies and to escape this new growing sense of overwhelming despair, small groups are beginning to now huddle together with others they find who are speaking the same language. But there are many separate groups forming all around. And as they try to unify, they are diversified. And as they try to converse, they are confused. As they try to understand, they are mystified. God miraculously mixed up the multitude by changing their lingo to mumbo jumbo. He twisted their tongues, basically, is what he did here. And God, who is the author of tongues, is indeed the God of tongues. And if he can create different languages as he did at Babel, then by his power they can come back together again as a miraculous sign to the world, just like they did at the time of Pentecost that we read about in the New Testament. And in one sense, Pentecost really was the reversal of Babel. As during Babel, the languages were confused. During Pentecost, the languages were clarified. Because if you remember, the people present at Pentecost heard Peter's speech, each in their own languages. He spoke in his language, but they all heard it in their own language. And both Pentecost and Babel give strong testimony then to the power of God to change things in the plans of humans and in the world itself. We have to remember too that back at that time when this account of Babel was going on, before this all happened, the people there really were a united nations. They all spoke one language and they all understood each other. You know, one of my favorite commentators, Warren Wiersbe, points out their weakness here when he says, they were motivated by one spirit of pride and one compelling desire to make a name for themselves. The only thing missing was the approval of God. That sounds familiar to me. So many times we do that. We move so far ahead of God and His plan for us that we're missing His approval. We don't wait and ask Him to help us discern what that is. And I think that's what this whole story of the Tower of Babel is really about. Not waiting for God's approval. Wanting to make a name for ourselves. Too often what we see as right in our own eyes turns out to be evil in the eyes of the Lord. And yet, the God of languages, who judges mercifully in this account of Babel, is the same God who proclaimed the gospel, the salvation message, in various nations' languages through those tongues at Pentecost. Through the Holy Spirit at Pentecost, God transcended the nations and their languages for the message of salvation in Jesus Christ alone. And we are to use this example to take the world, to take the word to the world, to all the people in all the nations. And since we are one race, one family, we should want to talk in all tongues to all our relatives. And that is why the Bible is being translated into every language that we can manage. It's a wonderful effort. So the people of Babel built a city, and they thought that it would be known forever. And in one sense, they were right. We're talking about it today. But in contrast to the tiny cities built by human hands, God's city will be everlasting. It'll be built on a grand scale with streets of gold and walls of precious jewels. And you can read about that in Revelation chapter 21. God's plans include an incredible way for repentant sinners to join Him as His family in this city by faith in Jesus Christ. And with His dramatic miracle at Pentecost, when people from nations all over the earth first heard the gospel in their own tongue. God let the world know that he had begun overcoming the effects of Babel. And since then, he's been patiently fulfilling his plan to call people to his eternal city. Out of every tribe and tongue and people and nation. Praise God for his mercy and grace. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
So again, I think this just contains a very valuable message that we are all one family, we're all one race, all one people. We're not to be divided and hating each other. We're supposed to be loving each other and helping each other as family should. And let's celebrate that by singing We Are One in the Spirit. They'll know we are Christians by our love. It's number 212, but we got a good video here with the words.
We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord. We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord. And we pray that all unity may one day be restored. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. They will know we are Christians by our love.
I'd like to play May the Peace of the Lord Christ Go With You, and we'll finish with Shalom to you.
May the peace of the Lord Christ go with you, wherever he may send you. May he guide you through the wilderness, protect you through the storm. May he bring you home rejoicing at the wonders he has shown you. May he bring you home rejoicing once again into our doors. May the peace
with shalom to you.
Shalom to you.
Shalom to you.